The Contiki. Raw 1. Raw 2. And now, Mr. and Mrs. Brian Norris's Ford Popular.
Who, a year ago, had heard of Mr. and Mrs. Brian Norris of 37 Gledhill Gardens, Parsons Green. And yet, their epic journey in EBW 343 has set them alongside Thor Heyerdahl and Sir Edmund Hillary. Starting only with a theory, Mr. Norris set out to prove that the inhabitants of Hounslow could have been descendants of the people of Surbiton who had made the Great Chalk March. No newcomer to this field, Mr. Norris's A Short History of Motor Traffic Between Purley and Esher had become a best-selling minor classic in the car-swapping belt. But why would the people of Surbiton go to Hounslow? Mr. Norris had noticed three things. Firstly, the similarity of houses. Secondly, the similarity of costume between Hounslow and Surbiton. And thirdly, the similarity of speech.
Oh, are you still loving the GTB TMDB?
Yes, but I've had the excess nipples wobble to remove tamping.
Jolly good.
Were these just coincidences, or were they, as Mr. Norris believed, part of an identical cultural background? One further discovery convinced him. The lawnmower. Surely such a sophisticated household gadget could not have been generated independently in two separate areas. Mr. Norris was convinced.
I'm convinced.
But how to prove it?
But how to prove it?
There was only one way to see if the journey between Surbiton and Hounslow was possible, and that was to try and make it. Months of preparation followed while Mr. Norris continued his research in the Putney Public Library, and Mrs. Norris made sandwiches. Finally, by April, they were ready. On the 23rd, Mr. and Mrs. Norris set out from Abidowee to motor the 15 miles to Surbiton, watched by a crowd of local well-wishers. That evening, they dined at Tooting. This would be the last they'd see of civilization. Mr. Norris's diary for the 23rd reveals the extraordinary calmness and deep inner peacefulness of his mind.
7:30, fed cat. 8 o'clock, breakfast. 8:30, yes, successfully. 9 o'clock, set out on historic journey.
On the morning of the 24th, early to avoid the traffic, Mr. Norris's historic expedition set out from Surbiton, destination Hounslow. Early on, they began to perceive encouraging signs. The writing on the sign was almost exactly the same as the writing in the AA book. They were on the right route. During the long hours of the voyage, Mr. Norris's wife Betty kept a complete photographic record and made sandwiches. This is some of the unique footage which Mrs. Norris got back from the chemists. Mile succeeded mile, and the terrific strain was beginning to tell when suddenly, by an amazing stroke of luck, Mr. Norris had come across the Kingston bypass. This was something to tell the round table. At this stage, Mr. Norris was faced with two major divergent theories concerning his Surbiton ancestors. Did they take the Kingston bypass, turning left at Barnes, or did they strike west up the A308 via Norbiton to Hampton Wick? Both these theories ran up against one big obstacle. The Thames, lying like a silver turd between Richmond and Isleworth. This was a major setback. How could they possibly cross the river? Several hours of thought produced nothing. There was only one flask of coffee left when suddenly Mr. Norris spotted something. Could this have been the method used? Hardly daring to believe, Mr. Norris led his expedition onto the 347. 40 minutes later, via Clapham, Fulham, Chiswick and Brentford, they approached their goal. Hounslow. Was this then the final proof? Something aroused the accountant's instinct buried deep in Mr. Norris's makeup. The journey was possible, and yet? Wrong Way Norris had accidentally stumbled on a piece of anthropological history. It was the inhabitants of Hounslow who had made the great trek south to the sunnier pastures of Surbiton, and not vice versa as he had originally surmised. This was the secret of Surbiton. Happy and contented, Mr. Norris returned to the calmer waters of chartered accountancy. For in his way, Wrong Way Norris was right.
Right. It's come to my notice that certain boys have been running a unit trust linked assurance scheme with fringe benefits and full cash and endowment facilities. Apparently, small investors were attracted by the wide-ranging portfolio, and that in the first week, the limited offer was oversubscribed 8 times.
It was Tidwell's idea, sir.
Shut up, Stebbit, I haven't finished. Oh, by the way, congratulations on winning the Italian Grand Prix at Monza.
Thank you, sir.
Shut up. Now then, this sort of extracurricular capitalist expansion has got to stop. I made it quite clear when Potter tried to go public last term that these massive stock exchange deals must not happen in big school. Is that clear, Balderston?
Yes, sir.
Oh, and Balderston, next time you do a panorama report on the black ghettos, you must get an exeat form from Mr. Dibley. Shut up and stop slouching. Now, the reason I called you in here today is that my wife is having a little trouble with her waterworks, and I think she needs a bit of attention. Now, which one of you is the surgeon? Come on, I know one of you is. Now, which one is it? Ah, Tidwell. Good. Well, I want you to cut along, have a look at the wife.
Oh, sir, why did you ask Stebbins? He's a gynecologist.
Oh, you rotten stinker, Tidwell. Is this true, Stebbins? Are you a gynecologist?
Yes, sir.
Right, just the man. How much you charge?
30 guineas, sir.
Excellent.